Indian women, we all like jewelry. So that automatically comes in to be a part of our portfolio, whether we like it or not. And as the time is going, art also becomes, because she's rightly concerned, and so would I, and so would some of us would be concerned.
What I'm just saying is that you need to look at it again individually.
Right?
And you need to understand that what I'm actually stressing upon when I talk about all these products is the understanding. Even if you're interested in art, do you have the understanding of the subject, first of all? Who is the regulator? What is the appreciation? Who are the artists behind this? Who are the galleries? Who are the end users of these art? So accordingly, if you're interested there, your understanding is there, you're aware of the risk, you're aware of everything to do with that product, then get it. That's the only recommendation as my thing. The real assets, the weaknesses. It's fairly illiquid, which is happening in today's scenario. You might buy at a time. It's very interesting. When you go, you will have a huge spread in your bid and offer. In terms of if you buy at a certain price from a broker, and then you at the same point in time, you try and sell it, there'll be a huge spread between that, which clearly shows how the liquidity stands in the market. It's very illiquid. Precious metals held in physical form may have storage and security issues. Low liquidity may create an illusion of price stability and have high bid-ask spreads. This is what I was talking about. So when you're buying it, you would be buying it at a certain price. Everything would be hunky-dory. You would be explained that things are great. You can sell it off at such and such targeted price. But when you actually go to the market and you try to sell it, you will realize that your ask price is completely different from what you bid. In the case of real estate, fixed costs can severely impact in a bad economic environment, as rental income as well as leasability can dwindle. For example, your rent may not come for the next 6 months if your tenant has moved out. So have you accounted for that income in your financial portfolio? Are you willing to forego that 4 months of not receiving rental payment? Is that a part of your, have you envisaged that scenario? So these are the things one needs to look at when you're investing in a real asset. Again, it needs to be a part of your portfolio. There's no recommendation which says you should not do this, you should do this. Never. But these are the things which you need to understand when you're investing. Financial assets, the strength is highly liquid, which is also a weakness because you're tempted to look at your portfolio on a daily basis. And if there's a volatility, you're actually tempted to just push the button and exit, which may not be the right call at that right point in time, because had you held on, you would have been sitting on huge capital gains within that financial asset itself. So, but highly liquid is a good thing, because if there's a contingency, if you feel that you're not willing to be in this product, it's best to get out of it and reinvest. So it's highly liquid, it's very well regulated. A lot of sectors in India, a lot of real assets in India is not regulated at all. But financial assets, again, like I said, are totally regulated by RBI and SEBI, which are doing they do an excellent job of regulation. A wide range of options to suit all various risk profiles, like I spoke about in the asset allocation slide, you will have low to medium to high risk product. So it's completely tailored to suit your need. If you have a horizon of 2 months also, you'll have a product like a liquid fund, which will give you a very stable income, and you can exit that after 2 months. If you're willing to stay invested for 5 years also, but at the same time you're a conservative person, these products have been tailored to suit your convenience and your liquidity and your risk. Ease and speed of transaction. Click of a button. The next day the money is in your account. Weaknesses, excess transparency leads to perception of volatility. Again, you're forced to question your conviction if you're looking at your portfolio on a daily basis. Because then the perceived risk, the volatility actually eats away into your head and you're like, I'm not willing to stomach so much. So you will actually take a call and move out of it. In a cyclical bad market, high liquidity and transactional ease does not pose a barrier for investors' incorrect decision of panic selling. Panic selling is very important for us to understand. Most of us actually create a lot of mistakes when we are panic selling because it's not a well thought out plan. You're taking a call there and then because of the easy liquidity and getting out of it. And the last thing, which is the most important, is no real touch and feel. It's just the statement that you get and just the market value that you see. You're not able to feel it or see the beauty in it, like you're wearing your gold. Extremely beautiful. Everybody loves to wear it. But there's no touch and feel. But the great key to financial assets is that you actually see appreciation on a daily basis or fluctuation, and that gives you a very good clue as to whether you're on the right path. Your ROIs are very, very well defined. If you're a strategic person and you have a very defined objective, a financial asset actually gives you a great kicker if you're on the right path in the periodic review. A real asset will be very difficult to review on a quarterly basis. It will be extremely difficult to undertake and understand the market situation. We're ending the presentation. This is towards the end of the presentation. Various asset type performances is just some data that we collated within the private bank. It will be very interesting for you to understand. Delhi housing market. Say if I were to put 100 rupees in 2009, what would be the value? These are values which we have obtained from NHB, that's the National Housing Board. That's the index which talks about the prices in different markets. I'll in fact show you a slide. In my interest, it actually talks about Hyderabad, Bangalore, Chennai, Delhi, Mumbai, the area. 100 rupees in Delhi housing market would have, in 2014, would be close to around 275. 100 rupees in the BSE Sensex would be close to 230. A diversified equity mutual fund, 100 rupee invested in 2009 in a good performing fund would be 325. A medium term debt fund, well managed, would have given a CAGR, 100 rupees would be close to around 275. And gold, 100 rupee invested in 2009 has given a return of around 375. And diamond escalation, 100 rupees in 2009 would be close to 250. Again, coming down to the real estate. This is the city wise index. You can just have a look at this. It's a little small. But these would be your real estate markets from 2007, the different indices. You can see the performance of these markets.
Sachita, I think you made a very good presentation because you said these are a couple of your last slides.
Yeah.
And I think we have scope for about 10 to 15 minutes window, I guess, max, for some questions that you would like to take. Then we break up for lunch. I would appreciate from all of you if you could keep your questions extremely brief and to the point and no comments, please. Because that can happen one-on-one.
Well, that could happen over that.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. That could happen one-on-one because those will be individual comments, right? Thank you so much. Nice, Sachita, for
your
question.
Thank you.
I want you to say, no. Can we use the mic, please? Is the mic, Matu, so that everybody else can hear?
I wanted to know whether in equity the seed capital is safe.
No.
Seed capital is not safe.
You're incurring a risk. Equity markets are very volatile. It's a high risk, high return product. It's defined as a high risk, high return product.
Okay. Because sometimes the bankers say the seed capital is safe, the returns may, you know, sort of be volatile. No?
No.
Yeah,
okay, you know, like in the volatile market, you have already invested in the equity or it's a balanced fund.
Sure.
So do I understand that you book profits? Main problem comes when to book profit. So is it advisable that one books profits in the diversified or the equity fund and park them in the debt fund? Would that be good planning?
This is an excellent question, ma'am. It's a very, very important question. And in fact, I'll just answer that. When you have decided that this is your objective, whatever the objective it is, you have discussed your risk-taking ability, and accordingly, you have a target, an expectation of a return in mind, an expectation that in these many years I will achieve that objective. Let's assume you're a conservative investor, right? And you have designed, you've sat with your financial planner, gone through all of this, these steps, and allocated money to 20% equity, 70% fixed deposit of bonds or debt mutual funds, and you have an existing portfolio running, you have some jewelry in the locker, or some real estate, etc. So this is your 100% allocation. If there is a rise in the equity market, right, say in fact this year has been phenomenal, the growth in the equity markets, what do you do as an investor? Say your 20% has become say 35%, right, you made a 15% on it. Do you book profits? Yes, absolutely you do that, right? Because your asset allocation states that you're a conservative person. You might say that you're reading the newspapers, people are saying, all right, markets would be 33,000, markets might be 60,000 in 2016. Why should I book profits now? I can get that extra money, I can make 15% more, but is that your objective? Is that what you've defined for yourself? Let's be very honest to ourselves. When we make this asset allocation, again, the greed of man is infinite. But if we are honest to ourselves, we will stick to our asset allocation. You'll book profit, put that money into fixed deposit, wait for the equity again to come back to 20%. You have to do that religiously. That is the beauty of asset allocation.
You can even park them in the equity and take further risk, whatever. But
absolutely,
what we say is it is very important to book timely profits.
Absolutely.
Based on your objective.
And it is very important to be honest to your own self. If you define yourself as conservative, stick to it. But the markets are going great and they are heydays ahead. Do not assume that you are an aggressive investor. Because then you are not being honest to yourself. You are going by hearsay, you are taking a short term route, you feel markets, you are taking a bet, a punter on the market that 6 months I am taking a bet. That is the worst you can do when you are doing financial planning. You do not take speculative bets. You define clear cut objectives, your risk taking ability, you stick to it.
Anybody else would like to ask a question, or would like to do 101, or this is our one question of the bank.
There's one slightly that about 20,000 rupees today after 40 years. So suppose I deal with the agent. So suppose somebody wants to
could you use that mic? Someone is giving to the mic so that you can benefit others also.
See, I work with the agent. So suppose in 20 years you're trying to plan for a retirement. So if it's 10,000 today, you need, let's say after 50 years, 66,000. What would we invest in today?
So then you would have inflation. Yeah, that's a very valid point, ma'am. This is exactly to show you actually what their purchasing power is. You need to have that corpus to have the same lifestyle that you've been able to afford with your 10,000 today.
And then it becomes double in 40 years. So then
you need to, so if you take an inflation rate of 6.5%, so you come up with a product or you invest in a product which will beat your inflation and give you that corpus at the end of that tenure. So you can decide based on your risk-taking ability whether a 9% may work out better for you or a 10%, but you need to take your investable surplus, work backwards and how that corpus would, putting inflation, how that would be in 30 years time and where you need to be invested in to achieve that. That would be your
target. Can we go for the conservative?
Absolutely. You can even work with the risk averse or with slight amount of conservatism built into the portfolio.
There was another question at the back. You could just pass the mic there. Another lady also wants to ask. Yeah.